Good afternoon. The government is in turmoil, with the Premier dismissing one minister in his government over allegations of bullying, while another minister clings to his job in the midst of the John Barilaro job drama. Let's go live to Liz Daniels, who is at State Parliament for us this afternoon. Liz, let's start with Stuart Ayres. He is defending his perceived involvement in Barilaro's US job appointment.
Lizzie, this is a saga that's now dragging on into its seventh week. It's followed the Premier all around Asia, and he lands back at home still dealing with this Stuart Ayres John Barilaro job saga. Today he's fielding more calls from ministers to stand down the deputy leader while he waits for an internal independent review into exactly what happened. Today, new documents are pouring fuel on the fire. Stuart Ayres forced to defend again his alleged or perceived involvement in the appointment. Now, what we know now from these documents today is that there was not one but two recruitment processes in which an eminently qualified woman was identified as the top candidate. In the second process, a woman outranked John Barilaro in every criteria, and the selection panel also warned that John Barilaro would have a severe, steep learning curve if he was to be appointed the job. Nonetheless, a week later, that same selection panel reissued a different report, upgrading his criteria, removing that warning, and alas, John Barilaro was handed the job. Today, Stuart Ayres at pains to point out he and Mr. Barilaro were never mates, and he also pointed out that he stayed at arm's length from the recruitment process. Have a listen.
I've not done anything wrong. There is no reason for me to stand aside. I just strongly reject the suggestion that any changes were made to the process to suit John Barilaro. That is just a falsehood.
Every time Stuart Ayres speaks, he's peddling mistruths. In the week after, his ratings are upgraded and his main rival's ratings are downgraded.
And Liz, the Premier has also sacked his junior cabinet appointee, Minister Eleni Pitinos.
That's right, Lizzie. So this was a late night sacking last night, declaring that more information had come to light as Dominic Perrottet landed over the weekend back in Sydney. It was only a few days ago when he spoke in India that he backed in his minister, saying that these anonymous bullying complaints against the safe work minister had been appropriately dealt with. However, over the weekend after landing in Sydney, he met with the head of the department, which she is involved in. And ultimately, the pair of them decided that the workplace that Eleni Pitinos in her ministerial office was overseeing was no longer safe for staff. And you could tell that Dominic Perrottet was incredibly rattled by the decision he made last night in sacking Eleni Pitinos. She has also responded to that, saying she would never deliberately offend anyone or cause offence. She denies these bullying allegations, which are very severe, Lizzie, and it just further shows the absolute turmoil that Dominic Perrottet is currently dealing with.
It does, Liz Daniels, there at State Parliament. The federal government has today announced a suite of new measures to prevent a crippling gas shortage predicted by the ACCC next year. Let's go live now to federal politics reporter Rhys D'Alessandro. Rhys, there's a substantial risk to Australia's energy security.
There is, Lizzie. With domestic demand for gas on the rise, the warning is we're heading for a 10% shortfall, the biggest since 2017. Next year, East Coast gas production will deliver enough energy to run 38 million homes for a year, but 65% of it is already committed for export under long-term contracts. Much of the rest of the gas is also being exported to cash in on high international prices. That combination could push up prices even further, forcing some businesses to close. The recommendation from the ACCC this morning was for government to consider intervening. It has the power to use an emergency measure known as the gas trigger. Resources Minister Madeleine King has now signalled she will pull that trigger, forcing exporters to reserve more supply for domestic use. But gas exporters are responding too. The industry body today reassuring customers there will be adequate supply next year.
The ACCC report is damning. No doubt about it. It sets out patterns of behaviour, instances of behaviour that are clearly not acceptable. It's an important early warning to us all about the potential problems we'll face if we don't take action now.
It sends a signal, and it's a signal that we will take on board.
Yeah, the industry body saying there's enough uncontracted gas, that is gas which has been extracted but not yet committed to a buyer, to cover the increase in domestic demand. So, although the gas trigger might not actually be needed, Lizzie, it would seem the threat from the government is enough to ensure sufficient supply and keep the lights on.
Rhys D'Alessandro there for us in Canberra. Well, not the news property owners want to hear today. A new report finding house prices in Australia are dropping at their fastest rate since the global financial crisis. Median property values down 2% since the beginning of May to $747,000. In July, Sydney recorded a 2.2% fall. That's the sharpest downturn in almost 40 years. Melbourne dropped 1.5%, Brisbane 0.8%, Adelaide and Perth recording the lowest falls across the country. And we will dig into those figures and look at where the market is going with CoreLogic's Eliza Owen a little later in the bulletin. Disgraced Queensland Mayor Karen Williams is this afternoon refusing to resign despite pleading guilty to drink driving after crashing a council-owned car. Meg Sides has the latest.
Redlands Mayor Karen Williams today pled guilty to one count of drink driving. She came under fire just over a month ago when she crashed her council car drink driving shortly after a Zoom call meeting with families who'd lost loved ones to drunk drivers. Today, the court heard that Karen Williams told police on the night of the crash she had four glasses of wine and hadn't eaten since 6 p.m. the previous evening. Her licence has been disqualified for 6 months and she will have to complete 80 hours of community service rather than receiving a fine. The magistrate describing it as a practical way to show her remorse and an opportunity to claw back some of her dignity. Leaving court, Karen Williams was heckled as she made a statement to media, once again apologising for her actions.
My actions were unacceptable.
Why didn't you get a taxi?
And I would like to actually acknowledge the fact that I've upset, disappointed and angered people who put their trust in me. And for that, I reservedly apologise.
Karen Williams remains on unpaid leave from the council and refused to take questions from the media as to whether her position as mayor is still tenable.
Well, it has been a busy start to the week in Canberra after the Prime Minister made his push to enshrine an Indigenous voice in our constitution. Green Senator and spokeswoman on First Nations, Lydia Thorpe, joins me now from Parliament House. Good afternoon, Senator. Before we begin, you made quite a powerful statement at the swearing-in this morning. Tell us, what are you hoping to achieve in making such a statement?
Well, the fact that we live in a colonised country and that I have a particular religion that doesn't fit with the one that unfortunately makes me sign up to as part of this job. We need people to have this conversation, and if it means that I have to pull a stunt so that the whole country can see that we are controlled by a queen of another country, I don't think Australians want that.
Well, that might be a chat on a referendum for another day, but let's move on to the PM's proposal for an Indigenous voice to Parliament. Do you support this referendum?
Look, I support the announcement and I see that as a real opportunity for this country. Yeah. Remember, there are three elements to the Uluru Statement, and truth and treaty are fundamental for this nation to mature. And there's some truth that we need to acknowledge the past wrongs. We celebrate Anzac Day and we pay our respects to those that have fallen, but we never acknowledge the frontier wars, the first war on these shores against First People. So truth-telling is imperative to healing, and it's imperative to any referendum succeeding in this country.
But do you support this one that the Prime Minister is proposing?
Well, I won't stand in the way of progress, and I will be in discussions with the government about other actions that can happen immediately.
So it's not a yes and it's not a no. Now, given the country's track record of previous referendums, do you think voters will need a few more specifics of what we are voting for in such a referendum? The PM's wording was a little vague over the weekend.
Well, one of the rights pertained in the rights for Indigenous people in this country. One of the key aspects of that is free, prior and informed consent. That should be applicable for everybody in this country. We need to understand what we are agreeing to.
And you have said that you are a sceptical that the nation is ready to debate adding a voice to Parliament. Why is that?
Well, we had a reconciliation movement 21 years ago. I'm not sure much has changed, and you only need to look at my Facebook page to see the racism that I cop every day.
If there is a voice to Parliament, if it happens in the next couple of years, what would that do to close the gap between Indigenous and non-Indigenous people? And in the meantime, what else can be done?
The things that we can do right now, is implement the remainder of the recommendations to the inquiry for Aboriginal deaths in custody and implement the remainder of the recommendations from the Bringing Them Home report. They need to put the money where the mouth is, not just wave the Aboriginal flag, actually stand up and make real change today.
Yeah, well, there's plenty of work to be done in this space. Green Senator Lydia Thorpe, thank you so much for your time on the afternoon news.
My pleasure. Thank you.